Hey there, it's John from Heroes and Legends, and welcome to day 4 of official Shadows Over Innistrad spoilers. So this is the 4th day of official spoilers, and the 4th day in a row that we get a new Planeswalker. As you can see on the screen, today we're going to talk about Sorin, Grim Nemesis, and I think this will be the last of them. 4 is actually pretty amazing to get in one set, but on top of that, we also have 11 other new cards to talk about that have been spoiled over the last 24 hours. So having said that, let's jump in since we've got a lot to look at. Now, the first card we're going to look at actually was previously spoiled in the leak a few weeks back, but now it's been officially confirmed, pieces of the puzzle. I won't go into a lot of detail on this one since we talked about it in a previous video. It's kind of a nice way to enable Delirium, possibly. Pretty cool card, but if you want my full thoughts on it, definitely check out the playlist. Alright, Indulgent Aristocrat is our first new card of the day. Costs 1 black. It's a 1-1 vampire with lifelink, and you can pay 2, sacrifice a creature, put a +1/+1 counter on each vampire you control. So, face value, it doesn't look like a whole lot is going on, but do keep in mind, it can sacrifice itself. So you could actually pay a black and then 2 generic and give all your vampires +1/+1, and that's all this card might do, and it could be okay. So I think in limited, if you have a lot of vampires, it's definitely worth running. Buffing them all can be very good, and early game, you might be able to get a little bit of value out of this 1-1 lifelinker. Other than that, I don't know if it's going to do a whole lot. Standard, even if there is an aggressive build out there, I think there's better things you could be doing than a 1-1 lifelinker. Even if it does kind of buff the team, your team has to really consist mostly of vampires, and I don't know if that's going to be the case. I think there's going to be maybe some vampires in a black-red aggressive build, but I think there's going to be other creature types as well, so this might not quite fit into that. Next we have Merciless Resolve. This is 1 black, 2 generic. It's an instant. As an additional cost to cast Merciless Resolve, sacrifice a land or creature. Draw 2 cards. So this is a lot like Alter's Reap. Costs 1 more, however, you do get the opportunity to sacrifice a land or a creature as opposed to just a creature. And that's pretty good for 2 cards. I actually kind of like this effect. This is going to be great in limited. I probably wouldn't hesitate to play it if I'm in black in most cases. And it's just nice because if you're tight on creatures but you're flooded on land, you get an opportunity to get rid of a land, or vice versa. And even if you just need a certain color land and you're just flooded in one color but you'd like to be able to draw maybe the other color, this helps you in that case too. So I think this is actually a pretty good card, and it could see some standard play as well if there's a deck looking for this type of card draw in black. Olivia's Bloodsworn. Now this one costs 1 black and 1 generic. It's a Vampire Soldier 2-1, flying, can't block, but you can pay 1 red and target vampire, gains haste until end of turn. So it looks a little bit like Vampire Interloper, and if you played with that in limited, you know it's a very good card. It can be really aggressive, it can get in for some early damage, so you have all that going for it, plus you have the ability to give other vampires haste. Now again, it's just vampires, but it only costs 1 red to do it. I could potentially see this one making it into a more aggressive standard build, just because I think this has a little more universal appeal. On its own it's good, and if you get another vampire then it's even better, but it doesn't necessarily make you play with all vampires to be good, if that makes sense. So I think this could make it into a black-red aggressive build in standard, and it's going to be fantastic for you in limited. Next is Twins of Mauer Estate. 1 black, 4 generic. It's a 3-5 vampire, and the madness cost is 1 black and 2 generic. This one's a little less exciting for me, just because, yeah, 3-5 with no evasion. You don't really want to be paying 5 for that, so you really want to pay 3. But I don't know, is there better things you could have in your 5 slot? So this is okay in limited, and if you don't have better things at the 5 spot, then yeah, you're going to play it and you're going to be okay with it. It'll be fine, especially if you can get it out for the madness cost. As far as standard, I don't really see a place for it there. I mean, when you think about it, there's such really strong black cards that cost even less than this, like Calatus, for example. Stromkirk Mentor. And this one is a 1 black, 3 generic vampire soldier, 4-2. And when this enters the battlefield, put a +1/+1 counter on another target vampire you control. So Here's another one that's not super exciting for me. It's going to be great in limited, though. I mean, you put it down for four, and you're getting 5/3 power and toughness on the board, whether it's giving himself the counter or spreading it out to another creature. That's going to be just great for you in limited. You'll be happy with it. Aside from that, though, not really going to make standard play. Again, it's in the four drop slot. It's competing with a lot of good stuff. Kalatis comes to mind, but there's other great cards out there, too. Arnis the Storm. 1 red, 2 generic, enchantment. This one's a rare. When you cast an instant or sorcery spell from your hand, you may cast target card with the same name as that spell from your graveyard. You still have to pay the casting cost, of course. All right, so we're going to look at a card here in just a moment, combined with this card, which is got me very intrigued. So first off, it's called Harness the Storm. Feels a little trolly. Obviously, it kind of goes along with the storm mechanic and storm effects, right? Now, if you're familiar with some of Mark Rosewater's articles, he has something called the Storm Scale, which, quick explanation, means he prioritizes mechanics on whether they would ever want to use them again or not use them again. And it's called the Storm Scale because storm is the mechanic they would never, under any circumstances, basically want to use again. However, here's this card, and we're going to look at another card in just a second, which really seems to support storm. Now, maybe they're just trying to support it in other formats, but it just feels a little strange to me. I don't know. So anyway, let's talk about this card in particular. Now, here's the thing with it. You're paying 3 for an enchantment. It doesn't do anything when it comes into play. And unless you have a lot of instant or sorceries in your deck, it's not really doing a whole lot for you. And on top of that, not only do you have to have a lot of them in your deck, they have to be in your graveyard, and you have to have enough mana to cast them in multiples. So there's just a lot of ifs to make this a good card. So I don't see this making it into standard, and I really don't see this being played very often in limited, just because you'd have to have a lot of instant sorceries, and again, it's just very inconsistent. Most of the time in limited, you're playing a more heavy creature-based deck, so this wouldn't be that great in that situation. Now, there are some interesting instants and sorceries out there, and of course the full set hasn't been spoiled yet. Maybe there's more good stuff coming. We do have a lot of the cards with Surge from the previous set, stuff like that, but I just don't really see this doing a whole lot. As far as modern Storm goes, there's just better cards. There's Past in Flames. There's just other things that I think you'd want to use as opposed to this. So I don't really know if it would get in there either. You know, maybe a one or two of to try it out. I mean, I'm sure if you tested with it, you'd get a better idea if this is good in that format or not. But I just feel like there's just better options. And the fact that it's counting on having multiple copies kind of knocks it out of Commander and Cube and those type of formats as well. So yeah, I don't know about this one. I'm not really sure where it belongs. Kind of disappointing at the rare slot, at least for me, again, without knowing the rest of the cards in the set anyway. And here's that second card I was talking about, Vessel of Volatility. 1 red, 1 generic. It's an enchantment, and you can pay a red in a generic, sacrifice it, and you add 4 red mana to your mana pool. So this is kind of a ritual-esque effect, but I might call it more of a tempo play than actually a ramp play, just because you're sort of just investing the mana, and then you're just taking it out all at once. So you're not netting anything, but you're getting a little bit of a bonus on a particular turn, if that makes sense. Having said that, though, this can still be a very good effect. It's at common, so there'll be a lot of these running around. As far as limited goes, yeah, you throw this on the board, and here's where I think it will really shine. It's going to help you enable Delirium. Enchantment is probably going to be kind of hard to get in your graveyard compared to some of the other card types. So here's a way to get an enchantment in your graveyard pretty cheaply, and if you're able to kind of bank your mana and play a big creature or something one particular turn and get Delirium, yeah, that could be pretty good. So you want to make sure, obviously, you have enough good stuff to sort of quasi-ramp into, and you probably want to have some good Delirium targets. If you do, yeah, this will be good for you in limited. As far as standard goes, it just depends on what you're trying to do. If there's a deck that's trying to ramp into something big, like, for example, a Ulamog or something like that, I don't know, maybe this does see some play. I don't know if it would be consistent enough, though, quite honestly. Again, we haven't seen all the cards in the set. If there's a lot of good Delirium cards, then this becomes much, much better in standard. And then, yeah, could definitely see some play. So keep an eye on this one. I think it's going to be a little bit contingent upon the other cards in Standard. Now, having said that, this is also going to be really good in other formats. Commander, imagine the combo with this with like Sun Titan. That would actually be kind of awesome in a Boros deck. I could see this being a really cool cube card. And I'd want to test this in some of the other Storm decks, maybe Legacy, definitely Modern Storm. Don't know if it would be better than what's already out there, but I'd at least want to try it out. So, very interesting card, a little unexpected. I didn't think we'd see anything quite like this in this day and age, but there it is. So, we'll kind of see how this unfolds. And like I said, between this and the last card, is this some sort of prelude to something they're going to try maybe in the next set, which is a small set, so maybe they can take a little bigger of a risk because there's less cards? I don't know. I really don't think we'll see Storm again, but maybe they're going to try to make a fixed version of it. I guess we'll find out if this is a prelude of stuff to come. Next is Deathcap Cultivator. Costs 1 green and a generic. It's a human druid, 2/1. You can tap to add green or black to your mana pool. And if you have Delirium, it has Death Touch. Okay, so here's the thing. This is a rare. I'm just still not used to seeing mana dorks at rare. Now, granted, they're trying to give you a lot of upside. This mana dork gives you 2 different colors of mana, and it can also get Death Touch under certain circumstances, but still costs 2 to cast, and it's a rare. Okay. It's a good card, don't get me wrong, but I don't know. It just feels a little disappointing at rare. As far as limited goes, yeah, it's going to ramp you into stuff. And if you can get Delirium, a 2/1 Death Toucher is a great creature, so you'll be very happy to have it. It turns into removal in the mid to late game. And again, if there is a ramp deck out there, or even a strong Delirium deck out there in Standard, this could potentially be a part of it, no doubt. So yeah, keep an eye on it. I think it's going to be a good card. But like I said, just kind of pains me a little bit to see these type of things at rare. Traverse the Ulvenwald, and this is 1 green, it's a sorcery, and you can search your library for a basic land card, reveal it, put it into your hand, and shuffle your library. If you have Delirium, you can actually search for a land or creature, reveal it, put it in your hand, shuffle your library. So this actually feels quite good to me. Now, if I have Delirium, and this thing basically becomes a 1 mana tutor, where I can look for any creature or land in my deck, that's sort of absurd. that's amazing. Now, even if I don't have Delirium, I'm still able to pull a basic land, put it in my hand, and I can even play it that turn. That's also decent, especially if I'm looking for some color fixing or something like that. If I play the first one, it helps me get closer to Delirium for maybe the second one, where now I might actually be able to tutor for a creature in the future. So that's kind of awesome. this seems really good. And first off, cheap cards, always look out for those. Cheap sorceries and instants can be very powerful. And the fact that it's also a tutor effect and it's cheap, tutor effects can be very powerful. I think this is going to be quite a good card. It's going to be great for you in limited for both ramp, color fixing purposes, but also to perhaps be able to tutor for something in the late game. And it's definitely going to see standard play. I really believe that. I think it's that strong. I think this could see modern play. I think there's a long shot, but I think it could even perhaps see some limited legacy play. I mean, there's other tutors out there in legacy, so it's competing with some other stuff, but just the casting cost being so cheap and the fact that it's so easy to get cards in your graveyard in some of the formats like legacy, that who knows, this could make it there. Also very cool for commander, great cube card. I would even consider picking up some foils of this one. I just think it's a very versatile card, and I know it's early, but I just feel like it's going to have a lot of uses. Next, we come to our fourth Planeswalker, Sorin, Grim, Nemesis. 1 black, 1 white, 4 generic. Planeswalker Sorin, 6 loyalty, +1. Reveal the top card of your library and put that card into your hand. Each opponent loses life equal to its converted mana cost. Minus X. He'll deal X damage to target creature or Planeswalker. You gain X life. And -9, put a number of 1/1 black vampire knight creature tokens with lifelink onto the battlefield equal to the highest life total among all players. Alright, so first let me point out maybe the obvious. This card is amazing in Commander. So look at this thing. I mean, it costs 6, which is not that hard to pull off in Commander. And then the fact that it can damage all opponents when you draw an extra card, and let's face it, Commander, a lot of times you're playing big Battlecruiser Magic with some really big effects that could cost a lot to cast, and you pull one of those off the top of your library and you damage all your opponents. I mean, that seems crazy to me. Sorin can protect himself by destroying a creature or another planeswalker and gaining life. And also, the ultimate, again, just screams Commander, simply because you're going to have higher life totals and more life totals to choose from. Wouldn't it be uncommon maybe to be able to throw 31-1 vampires with lifelink into play? Now, they don't have flying, but that's okay. I think that's still quite good. So this card is just going to wreck in Commander. It's incredible. Now, let's talk about other formats. Limited, obviously, it's a bomb. You'll be very, very happy to play it. Now you move on to Standard. Now, it costs 6. Is it playable? I think it is playable. Here's why. Black and white are usually kind of grindy, control-y colors anyway. I think they can kind of draw the game out long enough to be able to put something like this out. And then once it's out on the board, like I said, it can protect itself, but it can gain you life. In these decks playing black and white, you know they're going to want to play Anguished Unmaking, right? So this is a way to get some of that life back for casting those spells. And just the card advantage is good. Even if something goes wrong and Sorin doesn't live very long, you pull a couple cards off the top of your deck and you do a little bit of direct damage at the same time, it could be very well worth it to turn the tide of a game. So I do think it's good enough to see Standard play. It's a little pricey for Modern. I don't know if it will quite get there in the world of Modern. Maybe someone will figure it out, but I think definitely Standard. And yeah, this is an amazing cube card, and like I said at the beginning, just gonna be awesome in Commander. The only thing you have to worry about there is putting this on the board and not getting attacked by all the players that you're up against, because I think the card's gonna be that good. All right, next we have a Transform card, which starts out as a land, and this was spoiled from a French language card. It's called Westvale Abbey, loosely translated, and of course it's a land. You can tap it for colorless mana, or you can pay 5, tap, pay a life, and put a 1/1 white and black human cleric token on the battlefield, or pay 5, tap, sacrifice 5 creatures, transform, and untap Armendal Profane Prince. So let's look at the other side of the card. And here's Armendal Profane Prince, 9/7, legendary creature demon, flying, lifelink, indestructible, haste. So this seems quite powerful. Now, let's talk about the upside first. First off, you have the ability to basically get this thing into play without your opponent countering it, because it comes in as a land, and then you can flip it. That's pretty awesome. It's also indestructible and has haste and lifelink, so as soon as you flip it, you're able to attack with it. At the very least, you're going to get across to maybe destroy a creature, get across to some damage, but you're also gaining life at the same time. Seems very, very powerful, right? Now, as far as flipping it goes, yeah, you don't want to be on the plan to sit there and make 5 tokens over the course of 5 turns before you can flip this thing on turn 6. That'd be much too slow. But if you have a lot of other small creatures, some sort of token generation, or maybe you just plain have a really wide aggro deck that at some point is going to pitter out, well, then this is going to take those creatures and make some use of them and give you something big that you can attack in with. Now, here's the downside, though. This doesn't have hexproof, so a tempo play is going to wreck you. So you flip this, sacrifice 5 creatures, and somebody returns it to your hand. That's not going to feel good. So as far as limited goes, play it in limited. It's going to be great for you. Even if it's just game one, your opponent might have to sideboard some sort of tempo play to deal with it for game two or game three, but at least it could steal you a game. And if your opponent doesn't have that answer, which they very well might not in limited, then you're going to win with this thing. It's just crazy. Now, standard, I think what's going to hold this thing back from standard, unfortunately, is the fact that tempo plays just wreck you. So I think it's just going to be too risky of a play, and just that level of risk isn't going to be good enough in standard, unfortunately. This will be fun in commander. This will be a cool cube card as well. But yeah, I think limited, this will just be perhaps game-ending in a lot of situations. That brings us to our last card of the day. It's Drownyard Temple. It's a land. It taps for colorless mana, and you can pay 3 and return it from a graveyard to the battlefield tapped. So this is a rare. I don't know. I'm a little underwhelmed by this one, and here's why. I feel like in limited, this could be okay. I mean, it works pretty good with madness. So if I had a lot of madness cards, I could pitch this and then still later pay the 3 mana and get it back on the battlefield. That's actually kind of cool. It's also good if maybe I'm running some other sort of colorless effects. As far as standard goes, I really don't know if there's a deck looking for this. I mean, there are some decks that run colorless effects, but I don't know if it matters much. I mean, unless some deck emerges that's colorless slash madness deck, but I don't really see that happening. I could be wrong. I mean, we haven't seen the whole set yet, but I really don't know about that one. And as far as other formats that you think maybe Commander, if you play some sort of like Armageddon type effect that you can get the slam back, yeah, you can, but you also have to have the mana to do it, and it's only one land, right? It's not as good as, say, Crucible of Worlds or something like that in some formats. So, I don't know. I'm not really sure where this fits. And maybe I'm missing something. I mean, let me know your thoughts on it in the comments below. But, yeah, I'm not really kind of seeing it, I guess. Those are the cards for today. And we'll be back tomorrow. No doubt there'll be more spoilers to look at. And then next week, we'll continue this up until a week from tomorrow, and we'll begin our full set review. So, hey, thanks for watching. Please remember to like and subscribe, and have a great day.
Hey, thanks as always for watching. This video, like all my videos, is made possible by the generous support of viewers like you on Patreon. Even a donation of $1 helps me to keep growing this community and creating better quality videos for all of you. Check out our Patreon page for exclusive giveaways and future goals for the channel. If you haven't had a chance yet to subscribe, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss any of the MTG news, spoilers, set reviews, product openings, or finance videos on Heroes and Legends. Talk to you again soon, and have a good day.